Let's talk about predicting the ionic charge of an element given its location on the periodic table, and then how to form ionic compounds from these ions. So if we look at the periodic table, we can break it up into two parts for this discussion. We've got the main group elements, okay, that I'm shading in here, and these elements are important because they are in groups 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. And so main group elements are going to have the number of valence electrons as their column number. Okay, and all of our elements want an octet of electrons. Okay, and so that's going to govern what we do in order to form these ions. And so what we want to do is make another couple of rules. Metals lose electrons, and then nonmetals will gain electrons to form negative charge. So metals lose to form positive charge, nonmetals gain to form a negative charge. So if we ignore this area of transition metals, in which we, and then the F block, which is down below here, a little harder to see, zoom down here a little bit. Okay, we can't predict the charges on these elements, and so we're going to ignore those for this discussion and only look at our main group elements. Okay, and so with metals, we know that our dividing line is pretty close to this step ladder here. Okay, so we've got a situation where to the left of this line we have metals, on this line we have metalloids, and then to the top and right we have nonmetals. Okay, so if we're forming ionic compounds, anything to the left of this step ladder we're going to treat as a nonmetal or as a metal. Okay, so the left we have the metals, except for hydrogen. Okay, hydrogen's special. And then nonmetals we're going to treat in this region. Okay, and we're going to treat hydrogen as a nonmetal. We're going to ignore the noble gases because they do not want electrons or want to lose electrons. They have 8, so they're out of the discussion entirely. Okay, we're going to leave these guys out of it because they're happy already. So for ionic compounds, nonmetals want to gain, and so starting over here with fluorine and chlorine and bromine and iodine, the halogens, they need to gain 1, so they're going to form a 1 minus charge. And then elements in column 6 need 2, they're going to form a 2 minus charge. Nitrogen, 3 minus charge in this column. Okay, because they need 3 plus 5 is 8. Okay, carbon is generally not going to participate in forming ionic compounds. All right, so we won't worry about carbon for now. Boron, aluminum. Aluminum here, our metal, is going to form a 3 plus. It's going to lose 3. Remember, metals lose. It's going to lose 3 to form a 3 plus. Okay, it's not going to participate for the most part in ionic compounds. Beryllium, lose 2. Okay, magnesium, calcium, strontium, barium, so they'll form 2 plus ion. And then 1 plus ion for hydrogen, lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, all those form a 1 plus. Okay, and so we do see that hydrogen can do either. Hydrogen can lose an electron to form H plus, or it can gain an electron to form H minus. And so the way we're going to treat hydrogen is if it bonds with a metal, it's H minus. If it bonds with a nonmetal, it's H plus. Usually it bonds with a nonmetal. So now that we know how to form the ions, let's form the formula units of ionic compounds. And let's start with these examples. Sodium fluoride. So sodium is in group 1, so it's a plus 1 ion. Fluoride is group 7, it's a minus 1. And so we're going to use the method of crisscrossing the charges to determine how many of each that we need to balance the charge. And so for sodium fluoride, 1 minus and 1 plus are all we need, sodium fluoride. 1 goes to 1. What if we have a multiple charge? So here we have potassium, group 1, plus 1. Oxide is group 6. It gets a 2 minus. So potassium oxide. Well, if we cross, 2 goes there, 1 goes. And so we get potassium with 2 potassium ions to 1 oxygen ion. Aluminum sulfide. Aluminum is in column 3, aluminum 3 plus. Sulfur is in 6, it gets a 2 minus. These are all, if you'll notice, metals plus nonmetals. For ionic compound, that equals ionic. Okay, so metals plus nonmetals give us ionic. Plus, minus, and we get a formula unit. Okay, so aluminum sulfide. 2 goes to aluminum, 3 goes to sulfide. Or 3 goes to sulfide, 2 goes to aluminum. So 2 to here, 3 to here. And there's our formula unit. Now, calcium oxide is a little trickier, okay, because by our method we would say calcium 2 plus, oxygen 2 minus. 2 goes here, 2 goes here, but we can simplify. Instead of writing calcium 2, oxygen 2, we divide by 2 and instead just get 1 each, calcium oxide. Okay, so when we can simplify, we do. We have to get whole numbers by Dalton's atomic theory. So the last thing I said a second ago about ions was that with nonmetals, hydrogen forms an H+. So if we have hydrochloric acid, we'll learn how to name this later. We have 1 plus for hydrogen, 1 minus for chlorine. We crisscross to get HCl. When hydrogen is bonded or in an ionic compound with a metal instead of a nonmetal, such as sodium plus in column 1, hydride can then form instead. We add an electron to fill hydrogen's energy level and it becomes a minus ion. 1 goes to 1, 1 goes to 1, and we get sodium hydride. So all of these are examples of formula units of ionic compounds.